I thought I'm about to pull the cord.
This podcast is brought to you by Onnit.com. Go to Onnit for all your supplement needs. Whether it's Shroom Tech, Shroom Tech Sports, Shroom Tech Immune, Hemp Force Protein, Alpha Brain. Listen, when it comes to supplements, Onnit is number one. Go to Onnit.com right now and press in.
Church.
Bam. And get 10% off delivered right to your fucking front door, right? No questions asked. Kick that fucking muley. Oh shit, this is what North Korea is listening to right now. Oh shit, it's the church of what's happening now, motherfuckers. Uncle Joey, the Christ killer, my main motherfucker, Felipe Esparza.
What's up, fool?
AKA, good to be back. The American Dream.
Hide those spoons.
Here we go. Fucking, if he didn't march too short, nobody would have known who this motherfucker.
Give us some Dracula, bro.
What's up there, Felipe Esparza?
Give us some Dracula, bro. You know, you could do it.
On the fucking stage.
The count.
Lee Syatt, what's cracking?
I'm disappointed for Oakland. They finally got an amazing team, and they got like a less than a two-year like clock on it. You know, they're going to Vegas. Like, the Raiders are kicking ass right now.
I know,
did they
man.
Win yesterday?
No.
Well, they lost, but yeah, they're going to be there for 2 years while they build a stadium in Las Vegas. That's like breaking up with your wife or your girlfriend, but she gets to live in your house still.
Yeah, but the weird thing is that, like, I would expect that no one would go. They'd be like, fuck the Raiders, they're leaving.
We're loyal, bro.
It was packed. Like it was 2 weeks ago now when Marshawn Lynch was dancing. Like, they have a DJ in Oakland Stadium, in the stadium.
That's Gabriel's cousin, Chino.
No, it's not.
I swear to God. Yeah, man, Gabriel Iglesias' cousin is Chino, the DJ from the Raiders. And he's also a DJ in the morning. He's a big fan of everybody. But they met each other at Tucson, Arizona. He goes, hey, man, we look. Is your father such and such? Yeah, my father's such and such. And then they met. They clashed. They met each other as cousins. Small world, man. They're both of their fathers are players.
But, yeah, I was just impressed with like, the Oakland fans. Because, like, all that we hear right now in L.A. is that the Chargers are empty. The Rams are half empty.
Really, the stadiums are empty.
Apparently, the Chargers are pretty. Are like almost. It's like a home team. That's what I heard. For like the away team, it's almost like a home game.
Yeah, man. I don't think the Chargers are gonna sell out a game till New Year's Eve when they play the Raiders there. And that's gonna be a Raider Nation game. I already bought my tickets.
New Year's Eve.
New Year's Eve, man.
Oh,
Raiders.
My God.
Oakland Raiders visit Los Angeles for the first time since they left in 1990 something.
So wait a second. So the game is on a Sunday?
On a Sunday, on New Year's Eve.
Jesus Christ. 11 in the morning?
11 in the morning.
One in the morning.
One o'clock
game.
Yeah.
Yeah, 10. No, 10.
10 o'clock
game. They got to get that shit over with early.
It's going to be an amazing game, man.
Yeah, that's a good game. Just going on New Year's Eve.
You know how crazy it gets, Joey? Remember that show we did up north? And that was the day that Tom Brady did the snuff rule, I guess.
Oh no, the tuck rule.
The tuck rule, yeah.
That's like a New Englander's greatest.
Yeah,
day.
And Joe Diaz and I were with Rodrigo doing a fucking crazy show in Modesto, and everybody was pissed off, man. Every black guy was pissed off. We were being driven in a bus by black guys, and that's the day you took that powder, but it was actually meth.
Yeah, it was meth.
I was like in middle school watching a Patriots playoff game in the snow, and you were doing meth.
Oh my God.
Do you understand? That show was crazy, bro. Everybody wanted to go backstage and party.
That whole area. Once you go to Modesto, they're all like, those little towns there.
They're like love. They're like family, man.
There's nothing to do but do comedy and then get fucked up.
Get fucked up, man.
Fucked up.
Like, they have no shame. You know, they'll tell you, right, listen, man, don't go out looking for it. We got it right here. Whatever you need.
Whatever you need.
Everything. You want hookers? We got it. You want a dog? My brother owns a pet store.
And you go for a drive, and there's nothing really in those towns. Nothing.
Nothing. Visalia, nothing. There's
one fucking club, and you do not want to go in there because you'll get stabbed to death. So you go to a hotel, they give you whatever fucking drugs you want, and it's just that simple. I mean, it's a fucking shame, like El Paso. You know how many grams of coke I snorted in El Paso? Like, I can't fucking believe I'm alive from all that. Because I used to walk to that bar. There was a bar you went to on Wednesdays.
So yes, yeah, so the little Irish bar.
Something. There was a little bar where the whole wait staff went. But yes. The whole place was, if there was 250 people in there, the whole place was high on cocaine.
The whole place.
The whole fucking place, Lee. You've never seen anything like that till you walk into the fucking room of death.
Were there bars just built for people to do cocaine in?
Bro, like, wherever there's a bar with darts, there's cocaine. I don't know. Cocaine and darts go together. I didn't know that.
It drives me crazy when I'm snorting coke and somebody's throwing darts.
I know, man.
I always think one of those darts is going to backfire. I get pissed. I had my brother, the guy I'm going to see, his daughter that has the cancer on Wednesday. He's a dart guy. So I get a gram of coke with him, and next thing you know, I'm fucking shooting darts. I don't want to play fucking darts. What am I fucking
doing? Man, I don't know. That should be a shirt, man. But man, we go together like darts and coke.
And the bathroom is always, you got to walk past the darts.
Yes.
So every time you pee, you get anxiety because you got to stop the game and walk past the darts. God forbid you don't have your hunting camouflage fucking suit on and one of those cokeheads throws a fucking dart at you. You know, it was a fucking nightmare. It was a fucking nightmare,
darts. And so is darts or that stupid rifle game, duck hunts, whatever it is.
Then they have the best is the dart league.
Oh, my God.
Like, you get together on Tuesday and throw darts. Basically, it's an excuse to get fucking lit on a Tuesday. That's all dart league is. By the time you get there, you can see the target. By the time you leave, there ain't no fucking target, okay? It's humorous. I'm not putting darts down or anything like
no,
that.
No, man. Darts is cool, man. I'm darts just is saying, cool, but darts and drugs.
That's a great point you made, Felipe, because I grew up in two bars.
And then?
That they snorted coke, and right away they would break the fucking darts out. And my anxiety level would go up to a fucking 1,000.
It seems dangerous.
It is fucking dangerous.
Man, if you're coked out, man, and doing darts, is perfect, man, because your nose already pointing down, so your eyeballs are looking straight ahead. You're ready, man. You could do a bump and do a dart.
It is fucking crazy, Lee. Fucking darts. I think I picked them up like three times.
Let's do it in Pittsburgh, man.
Some guys you got to talk to get coke. You got to talk to them while you shoot darts.
Unless you're in Pittsburgh, bro. It's fucking candlestick bowling and coke.
Oh, I miss candlestick bowling.
Bowling and fucking getting fucked up is another thing, too, man.
I remember I used to go to Houston. I used to go to a place on Saturday nights at midnight. That you went and bowled and we'd get coked up and he'd pop mushrooms and shit.
Mm, man.
And they played heavy metal music and I miss all that shit.
Me too, man.
I do not miss. I'm coming up on 10 years next month, Felipe. You're past 10 years.
Yeah, right? I stopped doing cocaine in 2009.
Yeah.
Because I went on a 5-day binge.
Really? So you went even 2 years after me?
Yeah, 2 years after me, after you. I was still going a little crazy in 2008, 2009, man.
Wow. When did you meet Lisa?
I met Lisa in 2006, but when I met her, I was already off. You know, though that one time I picked you up all crazy, you know, and I gave you like $200 to hang out with me for an hour. And you told me, I even hear, man, he's 50, take him out of here.
I'll never forget the one night you came to my house, and it was the weirdest thing, Lee.
We didn't even know what we're doing, huh?
No, Felipe calls me. I go, yeah, what's up, dog? I'm outside. Okay. We get in the fucking car. This is, I'm heavy duty junkie, guys, and here's your witness, okay? He goes, where do you want to go? I go, let's take a ride. I think we smoked a joint. We went behind El Compadre. I walked in. I took a gram off the guy. I got in the car. Now, you had money. You wanted to give me to buy coke, but you knew I wouldn't get you coke.
Yeah, I had $60 ready, big right. Dog.
And I got in the car in front of Felipe.
And you put a whole straw in there and you did it all.
And I did the whole gram.
Fucking. I looked at him like a guy
that he could not believe it, guys.
Oh my God, my mouth got dry.
On the drive from El Compadre to Highland and Fountain, it was instinct. That was where I would do, at that light, I would snort whatever was in the bag, half of it. And then when I pull up to my house, whether the front or the back, I would snort the other half of what was in that bag. So when I got on the elevator, I went right upstairs and took a shit. There was no questions asked. When I walked in the house, it was to go right to the bathroom and unload the first cocaine shit of the night.
And no cop ever saw you do a half.
I'm a professional, Lee. No cop is going to fucking see that.
See, I could never do that. I could never like be like you, you know, because you've been doing it for a long time.
At that time, I was ready to quit.
Oh, yeah?
It was just a mat. I was just either waiting for a heart attack. I didn't know what to do. And that's what I was doing. I was buying, and guys, at the end, I was buying a gram of coke that would kill a mule from El Compadre.
Yes.
And I would do two fucking lines, and the whole gram was gone. And I would stay high for an hour and 15 minutes. And then I would sit in my living room for an hour thinking of my next move. And then I would figure out the move and go out and get another gram at 1 a.m.
You were like the first person I ever see do a whole bag, like the 20 bag, and then go eat a burrito. Like, I couldn't eat after I do coke because I want to stay high. You know, I wanted to last.
At that point, Felipe, and this is a scary thing to tell you guys because you're not going to believe it, my tolerance for marijuana was the same kind of tolerance I had for cocaine at the end.
So you needed more?
I could open up a party with a gram. That's how I opened up the night, with my own gram.
How much would Felipe open up with?
A half a gram. Not even. Felipe was a gentleman. Felipe would do two or three lines or two or three bumps, and he was fine. I was a gorilla, Lee.
Yeah,
nothing,
man,
has changed from the THC. I just transferred addictions, but at least I know this going in. I've always had a high tolerance. If at 16, 17, I was already doing a half gram a night. I was 16, 17, I would buy a half gram, go to my friend's house. They were 16 or 17. We'd do two bumps. And who do you think finished the rest of that coke at night? Me. I'd go home, put in fucking Black Sabbath on an 8-track with the speakers on, and I'd just sit there all night, listen to fucking music like an asshole and cry, think about my mother and cry and shit like that. So I started at 17 with a half a gram already. By the time I went to prison in 86, a year before I got locked up, before I kidnapped that poor kid, you should have seen what I was doing. I was probably doing 7 G's a day.
Damn.
One in the morning to wake. This is when I was doing it. I couldn't function on it, but I could still do it in the morning, eat breakfast, and live my life. That phase was like for 6 months where I would get up and do a half gram of coke, eat breakfast, give my ex-wife a stabbing, eat a pussy, the whole fucking thing at 8 in the morning, and then by the time I got in the car, I was fine.
Me, I'm more like a degenerate, man. I'm a binger. I would like party, like start smoking crack, you know, when I started smoking crack, you know, like in 2004, 2005. And I would smoke crack, like I started on Wednesday after the Wild Coyotes because I had cash. And I would continue to do it till I got tired, like till Sunday. I would stay up for 5 days. Like, I didn't want to stop, bro. I didn't know what I was doing with my body. Like, I was like, man, I used to laugh at what's the name? Bonaducci. When he had that Bonaducci show.
That's right.
Yeah, and he fucking bought that bottle of cranberry juice and that bottle of vodka and started drinking it right there in the middle of the street. I was like, fuck it, what a loser. But then, like, a week later, I was doing the same thing. Like, I just like to just continue. I don't know how to stop. I just continue to go 5 days, no sleep till Brooklyn, man.
Well, I was a binger for years. But once I got here, I binged in the beginning. There was a couple places you could. Listen, to binge coke, you got to be able to go someplace.
Yeah.
You got to be able to go someplace.
You can't do it at home.
What are you going to do? I'm going to go home with you and talk about what, comedy till 8 in the morning? Well, this guy's joke. Well, let's put on an hour.
Let's write a script.
No, and then we talk about how we got into comedy and how our father beat us. I don't want to hear that shit. So you have to go somewhere where there's 20 people in the room. But then it gets creepy. That's a different type of creep. I couldn't handle that no more. I could handle it 20 years ago. But in 2000, that was it. By the time 2000 came, it was me, either a chick or me by myself. And that chick knew she was coming to the room to do one thing. Like, there was no misunderstandings. You're not coming back to the room to watch TV or listen to music. You got to break up the monotony. We got to do something. It was terrible. It was a terrible existence, you know? But just to think that in 2009, you quit coke, and in 2017, you're the American dream, dog.
Yeah, man.
You got a special on HBO. You know, you ask 2,000 comics, what's when they got into comedy, what did they write on the top of that page? And it was an HBO special.
HBO special. Even Mitch Hedberg, he wanted an HBO special.
When you saw Richard Pryor in those days, well, not really Richard Pryor, but when you saw the Rodney Dangerfield specials and the Young Comedian specials.
The Young Comedian, man.
They were all HBO. So that sunk something in your
to mind, every kid,
you know, which makes 2009 that much more special for you. Like, that's, people have no idea how much changes when, and you're talking to two fucking guys that were junkies. I mean, listen to us, what we're talking about, envelopes and fucking a gram right in front of each other.
Hermaphrodites.
One of the funniest things ever was that night in Modesto.
Yeah.
Because while they came in, guys, if I'm telling you this in any other way, I was so ashamed of myself. But there was nothing I could do.
It was done.
I was older than these comics. You know, we all went out together, but...
And you ran into a crazy friend from Houston that liked to party.
I was like...
That you were trying to avoid.
I was trying to... In those days...
And they were asking, hey, Joe, you got some?
It was fucking crazy.
The devil would ever work.
And I go to Modesto... And everybody up there is fucking high on something.
Oh, yeah,
at
man.
The time, that night, everybody was high on something at that show. And there's 15 people running around backstage, drinking.
They had grabbing
a,
cups.
They had us in a little room with booze and a garbage can.
The green
can
room for all his friends.
With
and
all
comedians.
His friends and shit.
And we got paid cash. We knew what to leave right away.
And then one of the kids came up to me, and I'm bugging him. Come on, get me a package. I get off stage, the show-ins, I didn't get a package. But his friend had something he could sell me. And I go, what is it? And he goes, it's speed. You know, like, all right, how much you want? $30. Give me the fucking thing. At least I got something. That was the way I was thinking in those days, Lee. I wasn't going to go back to the hotel room with nothing. Because I knew eventually I was going to get up and start walking the fucking streets.
Oh, man.
Take a cab to a bad neighborhood and make a bad mistake.
Oh, man.
I was at that level then that I already had. Once you told me you could get it and it opened up that thing in my mind, it wasn't going to close till I snorted something. If you told me in the beginning of the night I can't get it, then I went home thinking I couldn't get it. But once you told me it's going to be here at 8:30, and when I get off stage it ain't there, I'm fucked because I already opened up that valve of thought.
Is any part of you worried in like a new city with a new dealer? Like if you know the guy and you trust him, that's one thing. But my brain would be kill me.
Listen, man, people. Because of television and media and different things, you identify this dealer with this fucking dark character.
With a hat, with a feather.
Walks in the shadows with a leather jacket, and he shows up with a gun. No. These people are people who work at the theater.
Oh, yeah, man.
They work at the theater, right? But everybody's got a cousin.
Or they know somebody. Like in Hollywood, there used to be a guy that another comedian hooked me up with. And this guy used to show up with a tackle box full of drugs. Like he had Viagra, he had Xanax, he had coke, had weed.
Yeah, well, yeah, and part of it, I guess, what would be the person, but I meant more along
like
the
trust
of,
line. Like, what do you think they have in there or nothing?
Like if the thing is tainted or laced with something, or
no, man, when you're
dealing with this honor amongst thieves type attitude.
But when you're gonna, like Joe Diaz said, man, sometimes, man, you gotta just forget about all that. You gotta go for a long walk and find it. That's when you get in trouble. But also, sometimes you met a good dealer,
right?
But man,
so you have to trust the people you're getting it from.
I did that in Montreal, man, at the Montreal Comedy Festival. I was like, I wanted to smoke crack. I got fucked up. It was a Young Comedian show, man. And you know, when you're a drug addict, man, you can find cocaine in the moon somewhere, man. Not the best.
I could go to any city, Lee, and by the second night have a package. Because I could go on stage and talk about it. and I listen to the laughter, and I listen to the percentage of the room that's laughing, and I can figure it out that one of these motherfuckers is laughing, because only a certain person would get the joke that I'm looking out a window. I can make a cocaine joke about Colombians and narcos, and a guy like you will laugh. But when I talk about I worked the peephole last night because I did a couple lines of coke, the people who laugh know exactly what I'm talking about. When I said I looked out a window the whole fucking night, people who do coke understand, because you don't know what life is till you get up every 7 seconds, Lee, to look out your peephole in front of your girlfriend. Your girlfriend will finally go, Lee, why are you looking at the people? Nothing, I just hear something out there. You don't know what paranoia is. That's paranoia.
Hell yeah.
You're sitting there watching the fucking New England Patriot game at 10 in the morning. You put 10 or 15 bumps in you, or you bump up from the night before, and next thing you know, you start looking at shadows under the fucking door. You see them. The speed makes your mind see somebody's feet come up to the door there and listen, and they walk away. So in your mind, somebody's coming up to the door, they put the ear on the door, and then they run away. They run around the block, they get refueled, and they do it all over again.
And you're going to catch him one of these times.
Paranoia, and man, Felipe's been there.
5 days straight, man, doing crack. On the sixth day, you're already seeing things, bro. You're having long conversations. Time, you don't even know what time it is. Time goes by fast.
There's a movie, The Temptations. They always put it on VH1.
David Ruffin.
And that scene with Ruffin, when he goes up to he's doing coke or crack in a den. And he goes up to the deal and he goes, man, come on, give me another fucking fix. And the guy goes, you already out of fixes. He goes, how about 2 tickets for the Temptations? He goes, the Temptations? He goes, these are 2 tickets for the Temptations. The guy grabs and looks at him and he goes, these are tickets for yesterday. Then he gives him his fucking car. That's...
Damn, I missed another show.
Can you imagine that, Lee?
Fuck, man.
Can you imagine getting together with a girl on a Sunday night and you don't make it to podcast on Monday? Like, you just don't make it. You just don't get home till Tuesday morning.
Is my phone ringing?
Nothing. Your phone is dead. You're at the Holiday Inn down the corner. You got there Sunday night with some broad. You called your girl and told her you were Joey at the podcast studio, that you might be there all night. She calls you at 6 before she goes to work. You pick up the phone and go out to the balcony and tell her you fell asleep on the couch, that you got really high and you don't feel good and you're going to go back to bed. You'll be home in a little while. She goes to work. You give that chick another stabbing. You look around the room and there's still a little coke rock left and there's still 6 beers left. Shit. Mm-mm. You're going to start doing that coke again. That chick's naked on the table. You're going to wake her up, eat her pussy, and start all over again. Next thing you know, it's 11 o'clock and they're calling you. Are you going to stay in your room again, Mr. Lee, for another day?
Oh, my God.
Well, ain't nobody going nowhere. You have no idea, Lee. You have no idea. You don't care about your job, your employers, your families, what commitments you had. It really doesn't matter when you're on a fucking tear.
I know, man. You should have checked out a long time ago. You have a plane to take off. You're there an extra day.
You don't give a fuck. You're
pounding more bills to yourself.
It is something that... Well, not anymore. I'm not going to lie to you. Not anymore. It doesn't bother me like it did 4 or 5 years ago. It was still bothering me because I'd still get vivid memories of that weekend in Beaumont when I went to the fucking neo-Nazis and bought coke. Do you know what that's like? That day, Slade's brother took me to the other side of Beaumont, and they had SWAT stickers on the wall and shit. And I go, are you fucking kidding me? But let me tell you something, Felipe, you know me. It was one of the top 10 cocaines I ever bought on the road in 30 years. That's how good that Nazi coke was. It was yellow as fuck. That Nazi coke at 4 in the morning, that shit took me to a different fucking level. It was yellow and it was real. It was flaky. It wasn't cut. $200 they gave me an 8-ball at 4:30 in the fucking morning. Who buys an 8-ball at 4:30 in the morning? That's like a death sentence, Lee. An 8-ball at 4:30 in the morning.
Would you guys have like... I know you probably didn't go back to the Nazis. Maybe you did. I don't know.
I don't know. I only went one time.
But did you have, like, if you were going to go to... I know you're going to say Houston, but maybe in, like, Idaho, did you have like, this dealer's got this and I can't wait to go there?
Oh, yeah.
He knew you were Cuban?
Huh?
Did the guy care you were Cuban? He didn't care.
He cared that I was in a movie at the time.
All right.
And that's all that mattered. I was in a movie. I was in their living room.
You're famous,
I
Cuban.
I was buying an eight ball, and I was fucked up, and so were they. And they just overlooked it. You know what I'm saying? They just overlooked it.
I went to an after-hour party with one of the waiters from the laptop. That black kid, light-skinned kid, a tall, skinny one from the laptop. He's always there. And it was like, man, it was like one of those after-hour black clubs, you know? It cost like $5 to get in. And the bartender was selling beer, and she was selling drugs, you know? And beer and drugs. And I went there with two comedians named Keith Manning and Theo Taylor, two black guys. But they had a pool table. But not only that, man, they were serving food too. Like southern food, like bodang balls. I don't even know what that is. They're like balls with fucking like rice and ground beef inside, dipped in gravy. And of course, they got me there. You know, like I wanted to buy a Coke. So the first line was perfect. You know, like, fuck, man. You know, it was like the best Coke ever. Like, it really brought me down. Like, it was fucking good, man. Like, so I said, fuck it, give me three of them. But after that, man, I could never.
They were fugazis.
Fuck, no, man. I could never reach that level again, you know? I was just chasing the dragon.
Oh, no. Well, the first package. But it's like the first bong out of the
good, man. It was like, ooh, man. I was like, yeah, man. It's going to be a badass party. Order some Bodan balls.
I had a meeting 2 weeks ago.
Man.
I met a dude at Marie T.
Holmes Road. Holmes Road, it's called. Holmes Road in Houston.
And the guy's very sweet. And he said, hey, man, my buddy's writing a book about disco. And he comes here. Do you mind talking to him for 10 minutes? About 2 weeks ago, I went down to Marie T a little early, and I met the guy. The guy was gay, very sweet. We talked about a few discos in the city. And we were talking about, he got on cocaine. He goes, do you mind if I ask you? And I said, bring it on. And he goes, you know what? And I asked him what, I told him what streets I copped at and shit. But the most important thing that I broke down from Felipe, and I didn't realize it until I got in the car, was that coke from the 80s, when you first did a blast of that shit. And I remember going to Miami in 84, Felipe. And the cocaine in Miami at the time that they had was making your eyes red.
Mm.
You weren't getting fucking speedy or nothing. You were just fucking lit. And your eyes got that red vein in them. And you stayed up for a day, but you weren't speedy. You just stayed up. Like, it was like a weird energy. But if you really tried, you could fall asleep if you really tried. Later on, you couldn't sleep for shit. You try to lay down and your fucking heart's pounding out of your fucking shirt. You have no idea.
Sweating from your chest.
And you couldn't drink enough beer to like...
No, man, no.
The cocaine burns through alcohol, Lee.
Yeah, man.
That's why it's one thing balances the other. So you get to a point between the alcohol, the nicotine, the THC...
And the coke.
The pills and the coke. Everything is fucking running together. You know what I'm saying? Like, they talk about the... somebody said to me, did you ever see Hunter S. Thompson's drug menu? Listen, I lived it. You know what I'm saying? What are you talking about? Except for the morning stuff, I was never a really morning drug guy.
Me neither,
especially,
man.
Especially the last 20 years. I was too busy doing this shit. So you can be high in the morning. I never was a day drinker. That never happened. I don't like alcohol at night. Never mind at 2 in the fucking afternoon when I'm going to get a headache the rest of the fucking day. But my shit at night, I went and went fucking deep and hard. And listen, I'm not glamorizing it by no means. I'm just showing you, even Felipe, that in 2009, Felipe was still out. And I remember I would wake up some mornings and I'd have a missed call from Felipe at 6:15 in the morning. I go, wow. And I'd call him up, what are you doing? By that time, he already copped. And he'd be telling me, I'm writing, dog. I woke up, I did some push-ups. And I wouldn't put it together why Felipe would call me at a quarter to 7 in the fucking morning. And I've been there where you just, let me just call. In your mind, you're like, let me just call Felipe. Maybe he's holding. You know what I'm saying? I remember one day, there was a guy, you were asking about drug dealers, Lee. Let me tell you how wide open it is. Again, sorry to talk about this. This city, one of my favorite cities in the country.
Hollywood.
Houston, Texas, had a kid that would come to your shows late, and he would give you a bud, and you'd go, wow, this is Houston. Where did you get this from? And he goes, this is what I grow. And he'd go, I got six other strains. You want to buy something? And you're like, yeah. You'd go out to his cartilage, and he had one of those construction trucks with the pack, with the panels and shit. And I wish I was lying to you, Lee. I wish I was lying to you. He would open up the panels, and he'd have little jars of weed. This is fucking 12 years ago. The last stop was still open.
Yeah.
This was at the last stop when Rogan was headlining. Those things that you see of
Pete,
that fucking video that you see of Red Band texting me and me going off on him in 2003, that was then. That was then. This guy would show up to the shows, Lee, and he would have these weed containers. And then part of the conversation, he'd go, hold on. And it was like you were in that scene in Taxi Driver. I got fucking pills. And you're like, wait a second, what do you got? The one time he came to a show, he had Coke, Vicodin, Valium, Xanax, some tranquilizer you gave to retarded kids when they went over the top.
PCP.
He had something else. He had 20 different fucking things in there.
He must have been your favorite.
I used to give him $200, bro, and he would give me a to-go package that would fucking make a mule sing. He would give me like a half eight ball, fucking 20 Vicodins, 20 Xanax.
You have a variety pack
for Oh, my God. He'd give me fucking animal tranquilizers. You have no idea.
Would you do something like give you like your favorite drug dealer like a Christmas present or something?
All
or something
the time.
Like? Jesus
Christ. My Don Sleazy, I used to give him shit every year. Clothing, hats, whatever they fucking gave me that I didn't want, I'd pass it on to my drug dealer.
That's the Martel cartel?
Yeah, because I usually owe them money. So this would kill things for a little while. At least I got a package on Christmas Eve. You know what I'm saying?
That's funny. Sometimes you would
talk. Let me get a gram until
sometimes
tomorrow.
Sometimes you would take them to shows to pick up. You're like, you get a pair of 100 right there next to you. You buy them a drink. You just get right next to
him. I used to bring them to shows with me.
Yeah, I used to hang out at the Wild Coyote.
Yeah, drinking, I used to bring them to
having
shows.
Having a good time, like a little groupie.
I still talk. I talked to Don Sleazy.
Yeah, good
Sleazy.
Weed too, though.
Yeah, he has tremendous weed.
Good weed.
I talked to Don Sleazy 3 days ago. Armo, my Armenian.
Yeah.
I talked to him about every 3 weeks.
How about the Wolf?
But the Wolf is in New York selling real estate, making fucking money at the age of 70 fucking 3 or 4 years old.
You used to bring the Wolf around too, bro.
I used to, the Wolf was my partner.
You guys to show that, but I used to order extra burrito for him too.
Coño, the Wolf was a dear friend. I had him on the podcast about 8 months ago.
He's always little cars, huh?
I almost stabbed him. He came on here and his daughter told him not to talk about the old days, that he would be charged. And he came on here and sat there like a fucking retard. So I put him in a cab, and his ex-wife called me and asked me what I gave him. And I said, you know, he's the Wolf. You never knew what he had in that top pocket.
Never.
I knew the Wolf since 1988.
Is he named after the Pulp Fiction character?
No. He's named after his own character. He's the original Wolf.
He's a car salesman in Denver, right?
In Denver. I met him in Denver, originally from New York, an ex-weed dealer from Hawaii. Junkie New York, East Lower East Side.
He did also crack back in the day.
Oh, please. His family owned a string of pharmacies, and he robbed all of them in the 60s. They were Jewish, and his brother was the Jew Mambo King of the New York City in the early 50s.
The dance king?
Yeah, they were all the dance king Jews.
Tell a story, move his hand real cool, like, Joya, I'm losing my mind.
He would fucking do shit. He was the perfect partner, because when you're doing drugs like that, you have to have a partner, and there has to be an understanding that, listen, you scratch my back, and I scratch your back. You know what that means, Lee?
No.
If today, Tuesday, tomorrow morning, I wake up broke and you wake up broke, and God forbid you get a check that got mailed to the wrong location, and now you get it in the mail for $280, I get $100 off the top.
What?
Yeah.
$100?
Yeah, because I might get a check Thursday when you're broke.
It might be six,
and I might get 600. I might throw you $150.
So you're like a little mini corporation.
It's a mini corporation. It runs both ways, but there's times when we're both broke.
It's like a corporation, man.
And that's when I used to go. That's when I would put my cape on.
Okay, I mean, do people like abide to it?
Yes.
Like,
okay. Yes.
Because I used to hate God. When I was a server, no. And people would like pull tips. I'm like, I don't trust any of these motherfuckers.
No. This is life. This is brotherhood life. This is, has nothing to do with people do it because they want to do it. So when you have a drug partner that picks you up every day at 1 and goes, "What's the schedule for the day?" And you're like, "Well, how much gas you got?" You know what I'm saying? How much gas you got? That's number one. How much gas do we have to work with? Because we're broke. So we might have to fucking take a ride somewhere and pick up an oven. You know, you never know what you got to do here.
What are you going to do with an oven?
You never know. It's quick 50.
You might got to drive Chewy around.
Who gives a fuck, Lee? 50? When you're doing drugs, it doesn't matter. Every day is an adventure.
Yeah, man.
You're not living on that fucking computer. And I'm not saying nothing bad. I just made a joke here. But you wake up. And you have $3.50 in your pocket. You got to eat breakfast and you got to get a pack of cigarettes. Cigarettes are $6 or $7 last time I checked. So you're already minus $3.50. So you hope Lee's still sleeping next door and you go, "Leaps, give me $5. I got to go get milk for breakfast or something." "I only got $7, Joey. Give me the $5. Hurry up." Because the first thing you need is a cigarette to get the thinking going. Because there's a roach in the ashtray from the night before.
Mm-hmm. "Give me $5. Hurry up.
Hurry up." And that'll hold you over till 11, that fucking roach. So you got to smoke that cigarette, smoke that roach, shower, and get out that fucking door and hustle breakfast. So there's a guy that'll give you an egg and sandwich and a Yoo-hoo on the tab. That's the first place you hit. You tell him how you fucking left your wallet at your cousin's last night. You got to take a bus down there and pick it up. You'll swing by later and give him the $3. There's no $3. You're not even taking a fucking bus. Nope. You're walking, bitch. This egg sandwich he gives you and this soda is your nutrients till who knows. You know what I'm saying?
Until you can make some money.
And you never know what you're going to do. You never know what you're going to bump into. Next thing you know, I bump into Felipe, and Felipe will go, "Dog, you're not going to believe this. You know that dude Lupe you don't like? Yeah. He stashes his drugs outside his house." That's it. We're on. We got a pipe. We got a mind fuck for the day. How are we going to do it? I don't know, because the fucking there's 10 Mexicans on one corner, and there's 82 on the other.
Yeah.
Unless you dress up like a fucking mailman and go in there and pick the rocks apart. I mean, Liam, we get creative.
There was a time when I got fucked up in Houston, you know, that one time? And I remember that young kid, they used to drive us around. He worked for the club. He loaned me a PlayStation Vita, one of those PSP. He loaned me a PlayStation. The little ones you hold, like a PSP.
Yeah,
PSP. He had just got it. But I was all coked out playing games with it, you know, and he loaned it to me. So when I took off with it. So I owed like $300, bro, and I never paid the guy. And I think Joy paid him for me. And I didn't even know. And then one day.
David!
He showed up to my show, and I had money, bro. And I said, you know what? I never forget people who took care of me. So I just said, "Bro, I know you owe $300. So here, boom, boom, boom. I give him $300. And then I find out from you that you gave him $300. But it's all right, man.
He was a good dude.
He was a good dude. He deserved that money, man.
He was a good dude. Him and his cousin took really good care of me.
He took care of me, too, man.
Over the years, you'd be surprised. David, I remember calling David at 2 in the morning going, "David, I need a package. I don't know where to go, you know. Can you give me a ride?" And David would leave his wife, come over, pick me up.
Yeah.
And give me a ride to the other side of Houston and get a gram of coke from somebody. You know, I was crazy.
He also took you to dumplings whenever you wanted.
Yes, he took you to dumplings, then he took you to the other place, the fucking
Rudy's Barbecue, I think.
Not the barbecue, but the fucking Kolaches.
Kolaches!
The Kolache place.
You know that place was flooded, man, area?
Yeah, yeah, it was
flooded. All those cheap hotels they used to put us in, bro, the laptop, man, it was bad. It was flooded, man.
How'd you do this weekend?
It was good, man.
Was it ready? Is it ready to go?
It was ready to go, man. I donated half of the money to the Houston Food Bank, and the other place was Friends for Life Animal Shelter. It's a no-kill animal shelter. They don't kill the animals.
Good for you, bro.
Like if you bring a dog. Like some of they rescued a lot of animals from the floods. So if you're missing an animal, man, go check there. They don't kill them, man. Like if there's a dog with no leg, they give them a little wheelchair.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. They have wheelchairs now, and they're bringing dogs all around the country. So check yourself.
So that was good, man. I felt because Sean Wynn was there when the hurricane started. He left. He did a Thursday show, but he was gone by Friday. Then there were no shows. So I'm like one of the first shows back since after the flood. So I sold out some shows. I was happy. Thank you very much. Houston Strong. But it was good, man. Because I remember, like, when we were struggling, like, we were taking any gig with Mark Babbitt, you know, and then we got booked, you and I, we co-headlined together at the Houston Improv. I remember, never forget that, man. I sold 35 CDs for $20, and that's pretty much saved me because we weren't making that much money. But, man, you knew everybody there, man. Because I remember that one night when I stood up for 5 days over there, I called you up. I said, you know anybody? And you could call up some guy named Jenkins. Not Jenkins, some other guy, man, some local comedian. And then I think I hooked up with a guy you're talking about that had all the drugs.
Yeah.
It was some little Mexican dude. Real nice guy, man. But gangster.
The dealer in OG. Houston.
Very gentleman over there.
My original dealer in Houston would show up to the club on Thursday or to the hotel. And
take orders.
And no. He dropped something off for me at the hotel to take the stress level down.
Orale.
And he'd say, I'm not going to collect till Saturday. Run it. Run the tab. So Thursday I had a package. I had to do radio Friday or Wednesday. In those days it was Wednesday through Sunday. And I didn't mind sleeping in Houston on Sundays because it was another party night on Monday.
Hell, Monday
was the open mic.
Yeah, the open mic was tight.
Lee, it was a long 6 days in Houston.
Yeah, man. And then it was packed, bro. A lot of locals.
I'm talking Monday nights, guys. Open mic, 300 people from 7 to 2 fucking a.m., 60 fucking comics,
and man, a lot of open micers and a lot of like
drinking,
locals will show up.
Booze, blow,
lesbians.
8 to fucking 10:30, for whatever they charge you would be one of the best shows you ever fucking saw.
Yeah, man, that laptop open mic
those
was
young
shit.
Open micers and those feature acts were brilliant, and then the headliner would stay. Because that was it.
Because you fucked up.
And the headliner from the other club would stay.
Yeah.
Because there was 3 clubs in those days. So you had 3 headliners on a Monday night. Place was packed, $10, you know, dollar beers till fucking 11. What do you expect, Lee?
Oh, my God.
And you would get fucked up every night, and then you had to get up Monday all over again.
Again. And then, like, right outside the club, man, like, I remember sitting outside in the curb of the club, like, with a bunch of people that were at the show. We were all fucked up, man. It was awesome.
It's awesome. Those are memories, man, that they're embarrassing, but at the same time, like I told when Ron White was here, I met Ron White behind the Houston Laugh Stop, 1998.
Tommy John.
He was opening up for Kathleen Madigan, and we're out there smoking a joint. And, you know, that's the reason why I would go. Listen, I would go to Houston because I had all my necessities covered. Good food. I always brought reefer. Or I had reefer down there.
Mm-hmm.
And I had the best cocaine out of all the cities. My cocaine cities were Houston. Dallas always played with me. Dallas, I could go to one time and I had more coke than Noriega. Then the other time, I couldn't get a fucking gram or fucking nothing. El Paso was always there.
Always.
The rest of Texas was always there. Miami, I was covered. Atlanta, I was covered. D.C., I was covered. Myrtle Beach, forget about it. It's right there at the club waiting for you. Forget about the Jersey clubs and New York clubs. All those clubs, there's always somebody who sells coke. Poughkeepsie, there's one dude at those clubs. You talk about it on stage. You walk over to the bar. As you're getting a drink, the bartender will go, that joke about the fucking blow was hysterical. And he'll give you a long look.
Sometimes you check in, and right away the guy who picks you up asks you if there's anything you need.
Remember that club we did in Iowa? Remember that gig you got me?
Oh, that was Whitey's Billiards in Dubuque.
And it was a fucking cocaine haven.
Yeah, the pool table, rednecks and Mexicans.
And the guy paid you at the airport and he gave you the weed for the night.
Yes.
Bro, he paid you when he picked
Whitey.
You up.
Whitey. That was his name, was Whitey.
He paid you when he picked you up, Lee.
Okay.
And he gave you a fucking package. And then he looked me in the face and he goes, I'll come back to the hotel and bring you some blow. And I go, I'm done. I don't do it anymore. And on the way there, he was telling me where we were, Dubuque.
Yeah.
Was the number one place for meth. in the country that if somebody saw that you had Dubuque plates, they would actually ask you if you had meth on you, because that's what it was known for.
The owner owned that town, man.
So the owner owned that town.
Yeah, like go, five car lots.
We check into the fucking, I check into the hotel my weekend. First off, you had to take two planes there. You fly into Chicago, then you got to take a smaller plane into southern Illinois.
And did you do the casino first, then Dubuque?
No. I did the Mexican restaurant.
Okay.
I'm talking about the Mexican restaurant. You got this get confused.
How's the Mexican restaurant in Dubuque, Iowa?
That's right.
Dog.
Because
they landed in Mexico. They instead of going to L.A.
The guy from Riddles drove you.
No. That was when I went to the mission. That was when I went and did the Penguins gig.
Okay.
You got me a gig one time where you flew into Chicago, and the guy picked you up on the southern tip of Chicago, of Illinois, and then he drove you over into Iowa. And
Mike Keo.
And they were the first Mexicans ever in Iowa.
Yes,
and they
Mike
opened
Keo.
Up a Mexican restaurant. He picks me up at the fucking
airport. There's a guy named Coco picked
you
up. He's
got like a spot on his face.
Yeah.
He got like a birthmark on his face. He picks you up in a truck, Lee. He gives you an envelope, and he gives you a fucking handful of reefer, which I already have.
East Chicago, you were by the Iowa, like the border.
Something
of it.
Over there.
Of the Mexicans were lawyers.
But the guy told me, where you're going, it's where meth is fucking invented.
Yes.
So if they see people with those, whatever plates, and I'm sorry to say the name, I'm not saying it correctly, I'm not here to insult your city. If he told me at the gas station that they did a big thing about it on HBO, everybody knows it's a big meth thing, okay. He takes me to the hotel. Lee, it's so fucking secluded that if you miss the 6 a.m. flight, you ain't flying out to the next day.
Hell no.
It's one of those fucking places, okay? I'm not sure if my wife was pregnant. I'm not sure what the fuck happened. But all I know is I get to the gig, and the mother's there, the father's there, the parents, everybody's there, the families, the wives with rocks in their hand. Everybody's drinking margaritas. Two comics went up. They brought me up. I did my 40 minutes. It was a lot of fun. They sold like 80 tickets. Okay. Second show, the parents leave, Lee. And all of a sudden, the place turned into fucking evening of monsters. Everybody, and Lee, look at me when I talk to you real quick. You know I never have to look at you like this. If there were 60 people in that bar, including the staff and the workers, everybody was on blow.
That shit turned to dust to
dawn. It turned from dust to dawn. Jaws were going. People were waiting online by bathrooms. Drinks were everywhere. I tried to do the second show. There was no
conversations.
There was no fucking nothing. I gave up after 25 minutes. And you know me, I'll beat them up if I have to for 10. Nothing. I got off and they were happy, bro.
That was when you said
that. They were so coked up. The guy offered me again on the way there. The guy's like, you want? And he was fucked up already at 11. I looked at him 80 times. Are you going to pick me up at fucking 4:30? I'll be there, dog. Better, I'll be there. I'll pick you up.
Was this a tall Mexican?
I don't remember, dog. I know he called me a few times. He contacted me maybe the first time I went had to be 10 years ago.
Yeah.
Then he kept calling me for a few years. He was going to bring me back, but he scared me. That shit scared me. I can't handle that now. Nah, where was he 20 years ago? I would have moved there.
Yeah.
I would have just fucking stayed. There was fucking broads. There was fucking drinking. There was a bartender. It was like 1980. I used to go to a bar called The Rooftop. $12 to get in, or you could drink from 3 to fucking 7. It was the same thing. People all over the place. Conversations, a line to go to the men's bathroom, a line to go to the woman's bathroom, everybody talking nonsense.
I think that guy's name was Sam from Chicago.
What is this, Jeopardy? Who gives a man. Fuck?
Shut up. So, Sam.
All I know is it was a fun fucking... You and me always did those fucking gigs.
Hell yeah.
Where the night ended up in a question mark.
Oh, yeah.
When you first get into comedy, you do these gigs with a night.
In Odessa, it's 17 people, but the guy's paying you still. Remember we did Odessa, the Wild Wild West bar?
Me, you, and Marilyn?
Yeah, no, Rudy. It was Odessa that was with fucking, what's his name? Roman. John Roman. And it was like 35 people, but the guy still paid us.
Wasn't that with Nicky Guerra?
Yes.
Are you sure that was the weekend?
it was like in a bar, bro, in the middle of nowhere in Midland, Texas.
That was where you got raided.
That's when you had the bartender had those big ass titties and she had a biker bar.
Okay.
Right there, those guys didn't give a fuck how full it was because everybody was making money there.
Yeah. Then they robbed the place.
Yeah, and everybody went to federal prison.
Big tits and the biker boyfriend husband, they got locked up, or she ratted him out, or he got out. She testified against some guys.
That guy was crazy, bro.
This is the comedy. This is.
I told you about that gig because I said, bro, don't worry about it, bro. Nobody's going to show up, but the guy still pays you because he loves comedy and he's trying to build a comedy scene over there. And that guy paid me, man. I couldn't believe it.
You pulled up to a trailer. That was a trailer.
Yeah. And there was nothing around it. Whatever money he'll give you.
It was a trailer.
It was a warehouse.
There was nothing around that guy.
Dust.
A couple of horses, like people, and people drove. That's the place where the people said, I want to take a picture with you. And I go, okay, let's take it. And they're like, we don't have a camera. And I go, so how are we going to take a picture? And they go, I don't know.
And,
I go,
how you and they're holding you.
Huh?
And they're holding you for the photo, but there's no camera.
No. The guy shook my hand, and I could feel how dirty the whole family was. The whole family was dirty.
Fuck, the two morosos,
daughters, the two daughters had no necks. They just kept looking at me like they were fucking Martians. Like they had never been out at night before and shit. And
real aliens.
The father waited till the end. And he shook my hand and his hand was filthy. You ever shake somebody's hand? His hand is filthy. But I mean like there's grease.
My dad is a mechanic.
And then he had on top of that, he had like that little mild salt.
Yeah,
you know, if he went to the beach and he put his hands in butter and he put them in salt, and then he dipped them on the beach.
Sure, that happens all the time.
Well, you never know. That's what his hands felt like. He had, in other words, he hadn't washed his hands in 3 or 4 fucking days. Okay, that's what his hands felt like. So after we shake hands, I go, "How you doing?" He goes, "You know, you were pretty funny." He goes, "Listen, you want to take a picture?" He goes, "Yeah." And we had like an uncomfortable moment for like 20 seconds. We're like, "You got a camera?" And he goes, "No, I don't." I go, "So how are we going to take a picture? How are we going to get it to you?" And he goes, "I don't know." He goes, "I just want to take a picture."
Damn.
So that's the type of bar that fucking was.
Man, the owner of that place, remember the biker guy?
The guy with the hair
yeah,
and the beard.
But there was another crazy guy that sold he sold ecstasy, but they gave me some weed, right? Then in the afternoon, after press, the owner called me up, "Felipe, we're going to go to the fights. You want to go to the fights?" And I said, I'm good, man. All right. No, we're going to go, man. We're going to go to the fights. It's fun, man. We're all going. Half of the town's going to be there. And I said, oh, all right, man. Then I started looking around, man. What kind of fight is this, man? No, it's dog fights. Oof. You know, my pet Booth fight. You know, I got $3,000 on him. And I said, nah, man, I don't want to go, man. You just take me back. I got to go over my set. I got to take a nap, man. I'm tired from radio. You know, fuck, dog. Is that how they get down in Texas? Like, an actual dog fight. And they're going to, like, he had a farm, and they're going to have it at some other guy's farm. And this guy's the only guy who drives a red Hummer in town.
Then there was the other place that the owners were Mexicans. But the kid who ran the club was white, and he was a magician. And he was married to two people, and the cops were looking for him. He had a warrant out in Houston because
they were all Esparzas, probably. We did a giveaway at Yete and they owned a club, and these guys were all Esparzas.
I don't know what they were. I know the town was whatever we did it. And again, I'm not here to disrespect any. I love Texas.
Texas rocks.
I would move to Texas. This place was fucked up. I don't know. It was a border town, close to the border. And it was fucked up.
McAllen.
The fucking the bar was owned by belt buckle Mexicans with cowboy hats and the boots. And when you got there, they gave you an 8-ball right off the bat on a fucking Friday. It was 4 shows. And the bar got busted a couple times. Jesus Christ, what about the other place? And where's Selena from?
Corpus Christi, bro. They get down over there, too.
Corpus Christi. I had some weird fucking...
Somebody left me a big bump in the toilet, bro.
Somebody gave me coke. When they had... Remember, there was a club down there that for years they tried to do something with it. And it had like a milkshake-type theme.
Yeah. It was the one that the devil bought before it was something else. It was a club at an empty fucking mall. It was a comedy club.
I did it with Marilyn.
Yeah.
Marilyn went down there. It was good money. And came Saturday night. Marilyn called me. She goes, "Joey, come come to my room. I have something for you. And I went over there, and her and Dave were eating fucking, God bless their soul, they were eating fucking chocolates and popcorn and salami and shit. They were hysterical. When they went on the road, Lee, they brought a fucking cooler with them. Like, I had never seen that. Not a cooler, you know, those big, big, big industrial coolers. Salami, cheese, Coleman, fucking beers, crackers.
Snacks.
They would go into a hotel room. They wouldn't have to leave. That's why she was 400 fucking pounds. Because she would just sit there with her dress on that bed, fucking eating snacks all day, licking her fingers and shit. I went to a hotel room and she gave me, like, there had to be 3-4 grams of blow. I go, where'd you get this from? And she goes, the owner. He didn't give you none. And I go, you fucking crazy. He didn't give me none. She goes, go downstairs. He's got something for you. I took Marilyn's and I went downstairs. And the owner's like, I've been looking for you. Take this. This is part of your payment. I stayed there. I missed that fucking flight. I didn't leave till Monday, yeah.
Well, what happened if, like, I came and I don't do coke? And he's like, yeah, that's part of your payment.
Looks like you're doing coke. You find a woman that wants to do it, bro. Doesn't have any.
When you come back, to LA, you make a few calls and you get rid of it wholesale.
Fuck.
Or you rock it up, bro. You order
up. People wouldn't give you nothing like that. It just, they knew. These are all, listen, you played at places that were legitimately, you played at some places that people wanted to try comedy.
Don't forget Bugsy and Tucson, bro.
Bugsy's and Tucson. Oh, my God.
Big Alex.
$150 Wednesday night.
$150 flat. Nice hotel.
They flew you out of Burbank.
What a gig.
The hotel was questionable.
Oh, yeah. It was like
a
haunted golf course.
Oh, but the tacos across the street from the hotel. The Mexican food across the street from the hotel. Oh.
You were there with Gabriel Iglesias on your first gig with Don.
When he lost his virginity. That's what me.
And Babe smelled like the trash and the can at Red Lobster.
And the chick. Mommy.
Yeah, mommy. Debra Gutierrez.
Now, if you went to Bugsy's and you brought a bug, they let you in on Wednesday nights.
What kind of bug?
That was like the ultimate gig, man.
If you killed the fly and you brought it with you on Wednesday night, they let you in for free in a baggie.
Yeah, man, you can hook up with anybody there, man. I hooked up with a pregnant chick.
Fucking crazy.
Where would they put that baggie?
Up your asshole, Lee. I don't fucking know. I didn't ask.
The owners, they just know what you like to party, man. They'll give it to you.
Oh, my God, Lee. That was crazy Wednesday nights.
And nobody missed that flight because they're going to give you another one.
And I was on the rotation. I was going every 7 weeks. Like, every 7 weeks, Rudy would call me pissed off. Joey,
you know how much Gabriel got there for that show? Because Rudy Moreno had asked me, you know any comedians that want to do it for real cheap? And I knew Gabriel Iglesias, Fluffy, had just started doing stand-up comedy 2 weeks. 2 weeks. But he was already killing. So I said, hey, man, I know this comic that I could do it. He got $60 and lost his virginity.
Oh, my God. And then $60 in a plane ticket?
Mm-hmm. And you flew out of Burbank, Southwest.
Oh, my God. I mean, it was like,
tremendous. It was tremendous.
We were spoiled. I don't know if we were spoiled, but it was like, it was good to have those gigs at the time.
You flew down Wednesday morning at about 11 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
Some dude who weighed 600 pounds.
Alex.
Picked you up in a fucking truck at the Tucson airport, and you went to a fucking restaurant.
Good fucking
Listen
food.
Listen to me, dog, Lee.
Oh,
he
my
weighed
God.
600 pounds.
Shrimp tacos.
What do you think that order looked like? When you got to your table, he weighed 600. He had fat on the back of his neck, Lee, like one of those guys on the 600-pound line. Like, he was one of those guys.
Yeah, man. He had
but he was mobile.
Yeah.
He would walk like walk. He would take us to that place first. You ate, and then you took a nap. Because, trust me, a nap
what
was...
What, we ordered, like, 20 tacos?
Tacos, carne asadas, cocktails.
They have good cocktails, man.
Everything. Just think of a table with fucking every type of food on it.
Like,
and he only pays $48 for it.
Shrimp, like, you can order, give me 2 shrimp cocktails, a shrimp quesadilla, and 2 fish tacos, and it was right there, man.
We got up to the room. You took a nap.
We started drinking micheladas.
And that he would drink micheladas. He'd pick you up at 7:30. The gig started at 8. 3 comics did 30 minutes apiece. And then they did a disco DJ.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when you met your little victim for the night.
Hell yeah. She stuck around after the show.
They stuck around after the show. You picked up your little girlfriend. They took you to this hotel where the door didn't close. It was crazy. It was a crack hotel. I was there with a chick one time with the comedian, a female comic, and she called me in the middle of the night that somebody was opening up a bathroom window and shit. That's a cracky hotel, but go there now. It's beautiful. They redid it. It's got like a southern, what's that? The western, yeah. Southwestern flair. It's orange with marble and shit. I was just there maybe 10 years ago, 8 years ago.
I met a woman there that she had a baby, bro. Like she had a newborn. And I remember we had sex, bro, where the baby was crying, man. And I was trying to keep the baby crying, going, shh. But, man, they have... I had a lot of good food in Tucson, man. You know, besides all that, I had ranch, French fries, and bacon bits for the first time there.
Lee, that's... We used
fucking to... Hey, man. And I remember you ordered a fucking 20-piece frozen chicken.
Let me tell you something, Lee. In those days...
We were fucking slobs.
We were slobs, one. B... We were making no money. So half the payment was the food in that city. It's like anybody knew that anytime you have any of those rides, Modesto, Visalia, all those Fresnos, anything Watsonville. There's a stop on the 101 North or something, the 5 North Lee. And he's my witness. That's why I told you that time. There's like an exit. There's a food truck and a gas station. And it was well known that on the way up, you always stopped there. And it was Yum Delicious, dog. I'm talking 20 years ago.
Mexican food?
Yeah.
It was talking about that place that you went in a subway? In a gas station?
Yeah.
Almost like a subway?
Yeah.
But you open a door and then you're in a Mexican restaurant.
No. They still had the food truck outside. It was like an old lunch truck.
Okay, I know what that one is.
You know what that one is?
Yeah, because on the side, it's an Indian restaurant.
Yeah, something crazy.
Yeah, but they're good fucking burritos,
man. Oh, my God, Lee Syatt. All that shit. And they were $3.
Whole back on the tortas, man. It was fat. And like if you order a chorizo torta, the fucking torta bread was red.
Yeah, you have to go to places like those days.
That place still there?
Anywhere I went, it was because I was doing comedy. I could practice my routine, A. B, I was getting paid.
Sleep well.
Not a lot of money. Sometimes I didn't stay in sleep. Sometimes I pocketed the hotel money and fucking drove back 5 hours.
Like a soldier. Like
I was one of those guys.
You're a savage, bro.
I would do that.
You would just cut corners.
No, I would go, fuck it. I'm gonna snort coke Thursday and Friday. My gig is Saturday. So by Saturday, I won't want to snort. But I won't want to stay up there either. I'll do the gig and drive back. You know, I would take, even though I was snorting a lot in those days, I would also know when I was taking the days off. I would plan the day off, so I would snort all the way up to that day off. You know, it was easy. It wasn't hard.
And then there was another gig, man, with, oh, my God, that Rick Martinez used to have with a crazy white boy magician in Stockton. That guy hooked me up, too, man. He was like, he showed up with, like, all kind of chains and shit, that Mexican dude. Him and his girlfriend in a van. Yeah, man, that was tight. So many dudes, man, like, wanting to start doing comedy shows.
You know, it's funny that...
Then we did that taping for no reason in Sacramento. We didn't know the taping. Well, at least I didn't know.
It's funny, Felipe, that we're talking about all these gigs. And again, this Saturday, you're on HBO.
I know, like, man. And it's an HBO... Like,
who the fuck
would have known? Who would have thought, man?
When we were doing those Wednesday night, and, you know... I talk about it on the podcast all the time that and we're just making eating, a living.
You, me, Ralphie May, man, just hanging out, eating a burrito and not even thinking about what's going to happen in the future. They're just eating a fat ass burrito. $60 doing Camachos.
$40 Camachos.
Then $40. Ralphie May would do go show up for $60
then you give
and a burrito and a buffet.
You'd always save me a green pork burrito.
Yes.
When I'd walk in, Felipe would hand me a green pork burrito with rice and beans. Oh, Lee, you have no fucking idea. And then I would raid around, do my little spot, hopefully that Willie would get off in time. And then I would do my little fucking time and get in that car and come back, hopefully pick up another gig or I'd have a spot at the Comedy Store. Those are the gigs.
They made me, man.
Yeah, they made who I am, too. And I'm, you know,
because I would do it every day. Yeah. It was every day. I knew that every day I had to make a $50 somewhere because I would add it up for 30 days. You know, I needed to make $50 because my rent was $295 at the time. I found a good spot to live in Frogtown right next to Emilio Rivera's house. a little one studio, bro, right next to a Salvadorian guy. Cerote, tanto ruido toda la noche, cerote, mucho ruido, cerote. And I lived there, bro, like, and man, I tried every money I got, I fucking, well, I used it for drugs. But when I was sober, when I didn't do drugs, I found another way to fuck up my life, you know? I started gambling. Like, me and Gabriel Iglesias, we would make $100 and drive to the Morongo Casino and try to flip it to 300, 400. And we would lose, bro. I remember we did a show with Dante, the comedian Dante, and he paid us, $700. And we pulled over to the Chumash Casino, and we fucking lost it all in 9 hours. Oh. And we were up and down, bro. Up and down, up and down. And I remember watching Gabriel's $1,300 go away. And he put his head down. He said, wow, there goes my laptop I was going to buy. And he missed the gig. He missed the gig, you know, because I know we stood there. We fucking didn't sleep. And we missed our fucking gig, man, the next gig. So I always found a way to fuck up my life, you know. I don't know if you ever had a problem gambling.
When I was younger, I did. I was
like an idiot, bro.
I didn't like it.
I would go to the horses.
I didn't like it. I like you calling me and going, hey, what are you doing this afternoon? No, let's go to Santa Anita. Let's stop at the ATM. I take $60 out. When I get there, we get a hot dog. We go for a walk. We smoke a joint. We bet till we lose the 40. Or if we win, we stay. Usually I do five. If we do five or six fucking races, we did an hour and a half. We got some sun. We had a nice hot dog cooked by dirty people. You had yourself some headache beer. And you bet you fucked around for a little while. What do you give a fuck? If you're going down there to make a living, that's a complete different set of rules right there. If you're going down there to make a living, you need to pay rent. So you're going to go into the horse track. And that's how you think you're going to make it. Good luck to you.
I remember you had a funny joke about gambling, and then you busted out. You busted out at Wild Coyotes, or, you know, we did a lot of sports bars, bro. Oh. A lot of places that had to turn off the fucking Laker game or whatever game that was on for comedy and didn't like that shit. And you said, I don't give a fuck about no fucking NFL. I wear a hat every Sunday. It says the Raiders -7.
No, I got a hat that says -7.
-7. Because so the Raiders need to lose by 7.
You mentioned that. I was thinking about a gig that day. That it was in a place that you did comedy, and right next to it was where you... I mean, guys, right next to where you stood, 50 yards from where you stood, was a fucking those basketball things. Where you shoot the basket, and if it goes in, it goes around, and you win a fucking prize.
Yeah, a carnival.
And I think it was the Sebastian Zatina room. So I went to the HaHa about 3 weeks ago on a Wednesday. Thursday, I said, he called me, the other kid, Zapata. And he goes, bro, you never dropped my HaHa on a Thursday. I didn't know you were there. So I was at the store that night. I go, let me get another set under my belt. I pulled up. I go in there. What the fuck was I talking about?
You were talking about seeing Sebastian.
So I saw Sebastian Zatina, man. And he goes, do you remember me? And I go, I never forgot you. You know, I go, how many fucking gigs did you give me? You know what I'm saying? Let's be honest. You paid the fucking bills.
He was the king of the Acapulco gigs.
He had all the Acapulcos.
Acapulco, Montebello, Whittier.
He had that gig where you had the fucking basketball court.
Yeah.
Next to the comedy stage. That was one of his gigs, man. It was weird how all these young comics had thousands of gigs.
And rest in peace to Rudy Medina. Who I gave him a shout out on my last
bad
special.
Motherfucker. I
told him, rest in peace, Rudy Medina. This guy was a kid who would show up every Wednesday, get heckled, and Willie used to beat his ass in comedy, like make fun of him. And he started doing comedy. And he used to book a pizza place that was 18 and over Tutos. And he would pay cash, man. Remember Rudy Medina?
Fuck yeah. He used to book the whatever country club. The Whittier Country Club. What's the other one? It was a country club somewhere over there.
Sage? It was in Orange County. I know what you're talking about.
No. What's the place you used to do? Tortillas.
Yeah.
By the hospital.
Yeah.
Same exit to go to that country club. So think about that exit. What was the name of the town where we did comedy? Whittier. It was the Whittier Country Club.
Ibiza's.
He had a gig inside the Whittier Country Club that I did 3 or 4 times. He was a great kid.
Yeah.
And he tried hard. And that's, listen, half the time, when you really love comedy and you are not getting booked.
The Montebello Club.
The Montebello Country Club.
Country Club.
And you don't know how to get booked. You know what you do? You go to a bar.
Start a fucking room.
And you start a room. And you don't, you're not Sinatra. You're not going to fucking pay your rent and drive a rental car because off this gig. This is money for you to drink and get a blast.
Pick up chicks.
Girl home. This is what this gig is for. So Wednesday night is presented by whatever your fucking name is. And next thing you know, on Wednesdays, comics are coming to your bar. They're trying stand up. And you're getting on stage every week, which is the fucking most important thing. And before you know it, you have 2 people. Then you have 6, then you have 16, then you have 34, and now you have 44, 45 people every fucking week. You're in business. You follow me? That's how you get into comedy. And listen, if it wasn't for Felipe and fucking Willie and Rudy, even Rudy with the Brave Bull, come on. I did that gig every fucking weekend for a year for the small 25, but it didn't matter.
And every once in a while, you could open up for a band.
Yeah, because the small 25 got you 100 a month. If you did 10 of those things, you paid rent, you did a couple.
Be clean, all right?
Yeah, you had to be clean. I ain't got to be fucking
Fuck
clean.
Fuck that shit.
Be clean. So that's how you become a comic. Let me give some shout-outs here, my brother.
Shout-outs.
All right, so Aaron Granger, my man, Joe T. Comedy. Comedy Papa Dak. One by one podcast, my buddy Mikey Stein. Chin from Taiwan, you little fucking cocksucker. I love you.
Chin's the best.
Chin's the best. Pepperoni Playboy and my fucking perro, Jeffrey Collins, the man of fucking steel. Always there for us one way or another. Tell the people at home how this special came. No, don't put the glasses on because you're upset. Tell me you're a young guy. You don't need glasses.
The special was DIY. I did it myself. I saved up some money the last couple of years. And my wife, Lisa Esparza, we worked together on it, with the production part of it. So we produced it ourselves. We hired Claude Shires, and he's a comedian. He has an Unreal Media. He edited my first special for Scott Montoya, the Showtime special. And we got him to direct the special. And everything we did ourselves, when the show ends, you'll see the credits. It says Craft Service, Felipe Esparza. I was getting sandwiches and feeding the crew all day before my show. And we did it at the San Jose Improv, you know. We did it at the San Jose Improv. And my agent, Chris Smith from ICM, he shopped it around, and HBO were like, they fell in love with the production of the show. Like, everything was right, the background, and they normally don't buy specials. They produce their own specials. They don't buy specials from unknowns, you know? I am an unknown. You know, they buy specials from, you know, the top comedians. So I was very surprised when they said they wanted to buy it, and they didn't want to change anything of it, you know, and they wanted to be at HBO behind it 100%, and they got me a bunch of press, and it'll be on September 30, produced by Lisa Esparza, Felipe Esparza.
So she's not managing no more, she's the producer.
She's the producer, exactly the producer.
You tell your mom?
Yeah, well, I told my mom about it, you know, she's happy. My mom got to see the special. When I was in, I had a show in New York at Caroline's. I was there for a week, and I went there with my friend Chris Thorin and Rodrigo Torres, Silent Bob, and I invited my mom, and she flew out.
Right. You took your mom.
She flew out, bro. We went to go see the Coney Island. We were on the same train, and she got to go to every single show, and she sat in the back and gave me a standing ovation after every show. A lot of jokes are about her, and she approved it. So she said, "No, pura mentira, cabrón. ¿Por qué mentiras?" You know, she thinks it's an exaggeration, but, you know, in her own way, she's proud. She's happy, bro.
That's awesome.
How long did it take you to work for the material?
Oh, man, it takes me, like, 2 years.
For the 1 hour.
3 years, actually, to get it right. It took me 2 years to actually write it, you know, to where where I know what jokes I'm gonna say, but it took me like another year to actually like get comfortable. Because when I do like my material, I like to get comfortable with my material, where like I don't want to lean on a closer. Like, oh man, I didn't get to do my closer. So once I know that my ending is sharp and it's closing hard, I like to begin with those jokes, you know, to challenge myself if I could keep the consistency of laughter. So I gotta challenge myself. Sometimes, you know, I have a bad set in 45 minutes, you know. The crowd doesn't know that the shit he said, but I know in my mind it's a bad set.
Oh, yeah, we've discussed this on the show before.
Yeah, man, so I gotta
you guys
do
are
what
laughing,
I can. Bro. I'm dying inside, bro. I know the shit's not working. I feel like I'm selling out.
It's very interesting that I pulled into town January of 97, and you're one of the first cats I met.
At the Laugh Factory.
At the Laugh Factory, but then we used to do sets on Sunday nights.
Damn!
At the Improv.
At the Improv and for Mercedes.
For John Mercedes. Is he alive? Rest in peace also.
This
is John Mercedes.
Also, we used to do the potluck when they put the names inside. Big Fat Chewy. A guy that used to give a ride to. To the hospital?
To the hospital. Now, let me ask you this. What was the name of the guy that used to go on stage? He used to say he was Spanish, and he played the fucking stick against the floor.
He was blind?
No, he wasn't blind. He'd go, oh, and he'd play a stick. He was one of the top Latin comics when the revolution started. I see him a lot.
I don't know who that is.
And I forget what his name is.
Not Larry Omaha, right?
No, we always talk mildly, but we keep it light. Because I really don't know what his fucking name is.
He had a stick?
Yeah, he would go on stage with a stick, and he was a favorite of... It was a whole different Latin scene.
I don't know who that
and
guy is.
Had, and it had a lot of...
O'Brien and Valdez, right? The duo.
No.
The drunk Irish guy and a blind guy. They were the first comedians I met, man.
Yeah, no.
Cool guys, man.
Yeah.
I met a lot of good comics, you know, like Willie Barcena, like.
Yeah. Now, what was the guy that he fell in love with a transgender and he moved to Texas with her and shit? So when that.
Ruben Quintana? Nah.
No, he. One of those guys became a born again Christian.
That's Ruben.
Ruben. And I called him one time.
He brought that waitress over from El Paso that was crazy.
He did something crazy.
He married a woman with 9 kids. That's crazy. And became born again Christian.
And he became born. And I remember I called him for a gig.
But he was an animal too, though. Before.
I loved him. Yeah.
He was cool, bro. Ruben Quintana was one of the comedians that I thought was so fucking hilarious.
I can't believe you brought him up. I loved him with all
He was the first guy I met at the Natural Fudge. Him and Byron Keith.
He was very cool. And I remember he moved. I left him a message for a gig. And he called me back. And he goes, how dare you curse on my answering machine? I'm a Christian now. You insulted my wife. You insulted my family. My kids are scared. I go, I'm so sorry, Doug. And I never spoke to him.
Man.
He never called me again. And I love that dude. We had wild conversations. I cannot believe you brought him. Because you...
Fool.
Let me tell you something, people. As cold-blooded as you think comedy is and whatever, you make certain bonds with certain comics. And my bond with Felipe is, you know, we're done till... They bury us, you know what I'm saying? And I know when they bury him, it's going to take a piece out of me. And when they bury me, it's going to take a piece out of him because we were here 20 years ago. We went through this together. We did the same gigs. If I got a gig, he got a gig. If he got a gig, I got a gig. That's just the way it did. Joey Medina, there was a bunch of us. Then when you seen
I was just talking to my wife about that, you know, because, you know, I did. We were all in Houston and we were talking on the phone. And I said, you know what? You know, somehow, someone always took care of me, you know, or I took care of somebody. And I remember, like, it was New Year's Eve, and I had nothing to do, bro. And you canceled on that black dude in Fresno, the bicycle casino, the 21 casino, whatever it was. It was that guy that was a radio station guy in Fresno.
Oh, shit.
Him. Bancroft, whatever his name was, that guy. And then you call me up, Felipe, man, what are you doing tonight? Nothing, man. I can't make it to a gig in fucking Fresno for Andrew McConaughey, whatever that guy was, man. And
good dude, man.
He was from the radio station. He's still there in the morning in the radio station.
He's still booking.
And he did like a Def Jam and got a nice radio job.
He's a good
Andre Covington. Shout out this guy, another guy, you know, and you couldn't do the gig, and I guess he trusted me enough to headline it. And man, I went there, you know, I drove there with my ex at the time. And man, I never forget that, man. Like, I had no money. And like, you just threw me $400 right there out of nowhere, Playboy.
When you live for the day.
And I still gave you money when I came back.
Oh, you came looking for me for something. It's so weird how you...
Thank you, by the way, man. I love you for that, man.
Guys, you...
I was lucky I had nothing.
You could walk around and I could go, fuck Lee Syatt. If somebody calls me for a podcast job, I'm not going to give it to Lee Syatt. Why wouldn't you do something like that? You take care of your friends, and guess what? Someday when you're fucking busted and nobody else believes in you, fucking Lee Syatt's going to be a fucking CEO of a marketing podcasting. I got an idea for old fat fucking comics. And I'm going to be, you know, at least I could squeeze a nickel out of it once a week or something like that. That's how life works itself out. I got very lucky. I did a movie called The Longest Yard. And I became friends with a lot of people from that movie. And I kept in touch with them. And I kept in touch with Nick Turturro. One day, Nick Turturro calls me. And he goes, I'm looking for a Mexican dude. Really funny. They're telling me I need to talk to this guy and this guy and this guy. Can you get him for me? And I go, no. I can get him for you. But I read the script. The guy you're looking for is Felipe Esparza. Who? Felipe Esparza. How come I don't know? I don't want to see somebody I don't know. Listen, it doesn't matter what you know and what you don't know. I'm telling you that I wouldn't send him to you if he wasn't the guy. So I said, this is the deal. I'm going to send him to you. You're going to let him read with you. If you don't like him, then we'll get you the other guys. But this is the guy. How do you know? Because I'm telling you, I fucking know. Listen, Felipe, you weren't outside the room, and he was calling me. He was so happy. That's the guy. How did you know? That's the guy. Joey, he reminds me of my brother.
Yes.
Joey, he reminds me of my fucking brother. That's the guy. That's the guy, Joey. He was so happy. And you know what? It was a movie role. Who the fuck is your movie role?
The Deported.
People work all their lives, ladies and gentlemen, to get a movie role. You don't know what it's like for somebody just to call you and go, hey, listen, go down there at 4 o'clock and talk to this guy.
And it paid well.
Yeah, it paid. Listen, we had a blast doing it. I had to put a mustache on. He told me to grow a mustache.
Oh, my God. He told me to grow a mustache.
And I shaved it off for a party or something. And then they had to glue a fake mustache on. It was just ridiculous.
They couldn't find Paul Rodriguez. They had to break into his house.
They had to break into Paul Rodriguez's house. He was eating yum yum fucking. He was eating something. They couldn't wake him up.
They could not wake him up.
This movie was I did like 3 or 4 days on and.
And then we had to wait 4 hours for Paul to get there, so we just smoked weed.
The biggest joke.
It was fucking raining all day.
The director had the worst comb over.
Oh my God.
You ever saw in your life, ladies and gentlemen. I'm talking about something that you had to stare at for 30 seconds.
He was David Crockett. Come on.
Oh my God. And you'd scratch your head, go in the mirror, and go, Lord, no matter what happens, I don't give a fuck if you make my head look like Vinnie Ward's. Don't do that to my fucking head, dude. Guys, he was working at him. Remember when Lee Syatt wore the button and he couldn't fit his shirt? Lee Syatt wore a shirt one time. And this button over here was Brooke Doug. He was holding on for dear life. I mean, that thing was on the cliff of death. You could see him. It was just like that.
Bing! It held together. It was a good button.
Do you know how many fucking people, Felipe, have called me and said, hey, what are you doing tomorrow? And I'm like, I don't know why. My buddy has a role in the movie. It just dropped out. It pays $800. You play a gangster. Come on. What do I got to do? There's got to be a by the way. You're like, well, where's the shoot? Santa Monica, 4 o'clock tomorrow night. You'll be out of there by 11:30. He said, guaranteed. They got a break for lunch. You have one scene. You know, shit like that. Lee, that fucking happens.
Yes, man. Like
that happens, ladies and gentlemen. I never want you guys. No. Listen, nobody's going to come up to you when you're walking on the beach. And
nobody.
Go, hey, we like your look. Well, no. This is after you've been here for a while.
Yes.
And you meet Lee when Lee wants to be a comic as an open micer. But for some reason, you were nice to Lee. Lee made you giggle. He got you high. And one day, Lee gets a job as a writing assistant. And guess what? Lee still comes around to watch comedy. But then guess what happens? Lee gets promoted to a fucking writer's job. And guess what Lee's going to write about? Us. And the next thing you know, Lee's calling you going, hey, what are you doing tomorrow? I got a day at work for you. Pays $8.50. You're going to work all day. I wrote this role about you being a garbage man sings with his dick out. Fine. And that's how it was.
It works like that.
For years.
Man, like.
For years.
After that movie with Joey Diaz hooked me up with Nick Turturro, I gave everybody on the set my comedy CD that Gabriel did for me for the Ice House. I just gave everybody one. And I remember the executive producer of that movie, the Filipino guy, Manny Redford. That was his name, Manny Redford. He loved the CD. He goes, Felipe, you want to make a movie out of this CD? And I said, what? I didn't believe him, right? I thought he was kidding. So I didn't call him for like, I ignored him for like 6 months. And then he said he was serious. So we had a meeting, bro, and he paid me like a lot of money at the time for me, for anything. He goes, I'm going to get a director and he's going to rewrite your stand-up comedy into a script and we're going to make a movie and we're going to title it I'm Not Like That No More. So, bro, this guy was not fucking kidding, man. He paid me like seven grand. And then that Hollywood works. I already had a one of those cherry tarp, what are they called? For that movie with Deported. That was like my first movie, so without SAG. So with the $7,000, I had to use most of it to get into SAG just to do the movie. Which I didn't care, you know. But I because of you and hooking me up with that movie and being nice to everybody on the set, I got to do my own movie starring Felipe Esparza. And then I got Paul Rodriguez to play my father in the movie. And the whole movie is based on my stand-up comedy. Like, have you ever heard of my comedy with
the
gay brother?
Yeah.
Life Raft, Threesome. It's all in there, man.
Threesome.
Fucking Tranny. It was amazing, bro. And that movie went nowhere. But I got to do a movie. Well, I got paid.
They had no marketing money.
Hell no, man. We went straight to nowhere.
The marketing budget was zero. That went straight to
zero.
Amazon Prime.
The dream is to have enough money to buy it and then release it.
And then re-redo it.
Re-redo it,
no,
yeah.
No, like just re-release it. Put Charles Bronson in it, the whole fucking cast.
Those dirty bastards.
How do you feel about Saturday's show? How's your set? What do you think about that set?
I think about it, you know, I did it a year ago, right? And I was worried about the show. The jokes might be dated, you know? But no, man, it's not dated. I try to like make it fun. I try to write a joke, man, like, you know, like Bill Cosby and Richard Pryor, you know, Paul Rodriguez, Rodney Dangerfield, you know, a joke that you could just quote over and over for days, you know, that you never forget, man. Like when I hear like Fraser Smith, you know, Fraser Smith killed me. You know Fraser Smith,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, he killed. Gotta get him on the podcast.
Yeah, bro. Man. He had that one joke, man, about when fucking Jack Kevorkian was still alive. He goes, Jack Kevorkian just added a waiting room in his doctor's office. Yeah, the nurse comes out and tells you, hey, the doctor will kill you right now. Come this way. And then I think that joke killed you, that Fraser Smith said about, just found out that the doctor said, and the news were saying, that spinach is really bad for people. So now's a good day to fucking beat the shit out of Popeye.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Yeah, buddy.
No more Fraser Smith jokes on this show, right?
All right, man. Enough Fraser Smith.
Justice and shit. Poor Frank.
Hey there, buddy. Good. I heard that these are going great for you, buddy.
Listen, let me tell you something, man. When I saw your thing playing on HBO, my heart stopped, Felipe. I got to tell you something. I wanted you on the show. I called you, and I said, what night do you want to go on? because I had to get you on to tell you how proud I am. I want the church people who listen to this show to understand. I know in the beginning we got a little druggy.
Yeah,
but that's to explain to you the debts,
the journey,
of where we were, and how strong the dream was. And guess what?
This is all I wanted to be as a comedian, man. I don't care.
We didn't know
I party hard, but in the morning, I show up sleeping to your shows. I'll sleep in the green room, but hey, I'm going to do your show. I need to get paid. I need to go up, no matter
what.
One
of the most classic stories ever that we could tell on here was that, you know, Felipe went to Houston, had a phenomenal week. You know, when he went down there, he ran into the obstacles that I used to run into. It's everywhere, and the people are fucking sweethearts. And you're doing a couple bumps here. Next thing you know, you're at a bar here. Next thing you know, you're with that Southern guy. And it's 6 in the morning. And he's taking you all over doing bumps.
Yeah,
you're at the Mexican restaurant eating, having fucking beer out of a coffee cup. And one of the nights, Felipe, one of the legendary stories that Felipe got the hotel room, the tranny, the whole fucking deal, lights the curtain on fire. You know, just classic Felipe. Monday, he goes all fucking day. And Monday night, he shows up at this most famous open mic and unconsciously destroys the fucking room.
I killed, like, man. Like,
just destroys the room. That if there was Facebook, they would have rumbled all over the country,
yeah, man.
Type of destroy.
I don't know what I said, but it was funny, man.
Oh, you went off. I had 20,000 calls the next day. People were like, are you fucking... Even Pete.
Pete
was mad at you.
Yeah, he was mad, yeah.
Lighting the hotel room on fire. Said that was one of the most amazing fucking things I ever saw. And what made it more amazing is that you had been up for fucking 30-something fucking thousand hours.
I've been up since Friday, man.
Jesus Christ.
Friday at 2 in the morning, man, I've been partying. Like a soldier.
We're here, Felipe.
I'm happy to be alive, man.
No, forget about being alive.
You know what was cool about that night on Monday? That comedian, man, the one that was touring with Cher, he was really cool with me that night. Like, he really, like, one thing I remember was that he's a married comedian, and he said that you can spend the night at my house if you need a place to stay. And then he stood with me, but I was, like, too fucked up to ignore him, but he was real cool. It was, Tommy John.
Something like that, yeah.
Yeah, it was Slade's friend, Tommy.
Yeah, yeah, great.
He toured with Cher.
Listen, bro, that was a great comedy scene.
Tommy John.
I'm very proud that I got to go through that scene. At that time, I used to go to Boston, which it was the hardest market to get
into. Oh, my God.
And I wouldn't work the top club.
I remember with the K Locos that you left.
I would work Grill 93 and go to Boston and then shoot down to the big one, Faneuil Hall. And I would do all those rooms, you know. I was very fortunate, man. But I had, Jesus Christ. Oh, my, Milwaukee. I went all over this fucking country.
But you had nothing holding you back. I had nothing holding me back.
No.
I knew I couldn't see my kids. You know, they disappeared.
No, I was in the same fucking list.
I couldn't see my kids. You know I had child support hanging behind me. You know, I was like,
you had to make
do or
cash.
Die, bro. I got to make cash. I remember, man, like, this guy paying me a check. I said, listen, man, what time are you going to get up in the morning? Because we're going to go cash this shit when the bank opens. He goes, what do you mean? No, we're going to the bank. You're going to walk in with me. And we're going to cash this check because I ain't going to open no fucking account. I need the fucking cash. Remember the Malachi tried to give you a check in Santa Maria? I will shove you up the other brother's ass if I don't get a fucking cash.
I was pissed. They're nice guys. I talk to Joe all the time on the phone. He's a fucking gentleman.
I needed cash, bro. Like, I
no, we all lived off of cash.
And I was working at Dodger Stadium at
the
time.
A fucking check.
Oh, man.
My blood would boil in those days. If I already called Julie and said, Lee, I got a gig at 8, worst case scenario, I'll be out there at 10:30. I'll be by your house 11:15. Make sure you're there with that fucking coke. If I already told you that, and I went down to Felipe's and he gave me a check, my blood would fucking boil. Because that would slow me down completely. That means I'd have to go to fucking Hollywood and Wilcox, park the car, walk all the way around, get a ticket, try to cash the check, get the ticket validated, go back. Are you fucking crazy? 11:30
at man.
Night, you're ready to snort that coke, and I'm parking, driving on Hollywood Boulevard on Wilcox, getting caught in fucking traffic on a Saturday night. My blood would boil.
Me too, man. Sure. Up until 2010, if you booked me at a show, you had to be there at the hotel room, and you had to put your own fucking name, and you had to put your own credit card, because I had none of that shit. I had no debit card. I couldn't put a deposit at no hotel. So every time I did a show, the promoter had to check me into the hotel because I had no credit card. I had no debit.
Me neither.
So the hotel was always on the promoter's name.
For years, I checked into the hotel with Joe Rogan, and he would put his card down for me.
Me too, man.
And he would go, if you're fucking charged porn on here, I'll kill you. And then he would go, I don't look at the account anyway, so don't worry about it. But I would never charge anything. But I was in the same boat as you, dog. I didn't have an ATM card for years. And if I did, it was always minus. It didn't matter. Then I got an ATM card and I kept it afloat. That always had like 3120 in it, 2850, you know what I'm saying? Like those numbers. Like I always had less than $40 and more than 20, you know what I'm saying?
I had a check cashing card.
From where?
From, I don't know if it was Knicks or one of the major ones. And I used to cash my checks.
Right no, there. I had one too. I got. I
remember struggling.
I'm
man.
I'm still on file at going
to, yeah,
Hollywood.
I would go to the
Please.
One. I would cash my check at the one right there in South Central. The one, the last one they have before the airport. And I'll try to get cash my check though, just to have enough money to go to my next gig and eat.
My God.
Well, actually, I went one time. I had to cash my check at one of those check cashing places with Lisa, my wife. And as soon as I cash my check, I just handed her the money right there so she could go run and pay the rent, man. I was giving her the check right before I was flying out to pay the rent. But luckily, we don't have to worry about that right now.
Listen, man, you should be very proud of yourself.
Very man up.
You know, the other day I was at the Dodger game with my daughter and a bunch of kids. And I thought about you and I thought about... I saw the guys selling hot dogs and selling ice cream. And I thought about, you know, I showed you what seats I were in. They were all the way in the top with their $15 seats. And they were enjoyable, but you really can't see the fucking field when you're an old man like me. They look like, well, you can't even see the ball. And they got no fucking teleprompter there.
No.
They got no, you can't see. You're fucked at Dodger Stadium, Jack.
Yeah, you're looking down at the game.
Yeah, you're only looking at the fucking teleprompter for an instant replay.
Yeah.
Besides that, there's no teleprompter. So I saw these guys delivering sodas and hot dogs and ice cream. And I said, fucking Felipe was doing this 30 years ago as a kid.
I was selling souvenirs, bro.
Super fucking
souvenirs. Get your programs, pennants, Dodger Koala.
And I go, right now, after his special on HBO, he's going to be one of the biggest comics in the world. It started right here. Who knows? He knows where this is his comedy first developed. It was like me going to prison. That's where you develop the toughness to talk and yell out into a crowd. And you know. But listen, man, I want the church family to... If you don't have HBO, how do you go to HBO to go? Anybody in the league?
On your phone.
Yeah, you can do it on any mobile device. You can do it on TVs. And you can do it without a TV provider. It's like $20 for a month. I think you can do like even a shorter period of time.
And listen, you know what? It's time you start watching The
Deuce.
It's
worth it.
Anyway, so you
the
might as well.
The Deuce is good.
You might as well watch Felipe's special. Sign up and watch The Deuce. And you got fucking Bill Maher. And you got a bunch of other shit on HBO. That's fucking tremendous. Don't believe the hype, bro. HBO's still fucking good. I watch HBO a lot. I got that HBO package, the five
Me
fucking
too.
Things. I watch HBO fucking a lot more than I watch anything else.
I watch Silicon Valley,
Listen, support
Insecure.
My brother, yeah. My wife watches Insecure. Come on, get it together. HBO's still fucking throwing heat, all right? Saturday night, 10 o'clock, check your local fucking listings. This is my brother I'm talking to you about. We talked about our history, so you motherfuckers know this is real. This is two guys who came up together. Addictions, you know, we could be here till 2 in the morning just depressing you. I don't want you to think about getting depressed. I want you to think about your possibilities if we were in the hole we were in.
Yeah, man, you could do whatever you want, man.
Listen, I'm not where he's at. This is HBO. This is gold. But this guy here, this guy's the guy you should be watching. Do me that favor. Felipe Esparza, number two. Do not forget, Pittsburgh Improv, Saturday, late night, is sold out already. You got four shows. Don't fuck around. Don't call me going, Joey, there's no time. I told you fucking Wednesday on the podcast, and I told you fucking Monday with Jim Norton. Don't fuck with me, all right? Listen, number two, for all your supplements, the holidays are coming, the new year, you're going to make resolutions, whatnot, bada bing, bada boom, bada boom. I don't want to hear it. You're having problems lately. You're getting a little older. You think Alpha Brain. Give it a shot. If you don't like it, you don't even have to return it. They'll give you 100% money back guarantee. You like the Alpha Brain, you're thinking about lifting, boom, hemp force protein. Beautiful, digesting, easy, nice. The best chocolate you've ever tasted. Two scoops with water, a couple ice cubes, you're fucking brand new. Maybe a banana, something like that to carb up. You don't have no fucking idea how you're living. You understand me? The Strong Bone, the fucking Shroom Tech Sport, and the Shroom Tech Immune if you're a fucking traveler or something. Hey, I travel, Jack. You know, you don't hear me coming in here all fucked up every fucking week. That's because I take care of myself, and I fucking take the Shroom Tech Immune. So just in case I got fucking weird people around me, I don't catch the Maluk they got. You understand me? Who knows where they've been, Sukalamink somewhere, or doing dirty shit. My point is, go to Honor.com right now. Go to Honor right now. Take a look at the great supplements they have. From the fucking turkey meat beef sticks, it's on. It's on. Go to Honor. Take a look at what they got. If you like something, go to the box and press in.
Church.
Boom. C-H-U-R-C-H. Get 10% off delivered to your motherfucking house, okay? And don't forget, it's football season. Go to MyBookieAG. They'll match whatever the fuck you throw in there, okay? Who's better than them? What's the code for them?
I believe it's church.
That, boom, there you go. And that's how we're rolling, and we love you motherfuckers. Have a great fucking weekend, and we'll talk to you motherfuckers next Monday. Do not forget my brother, Felipe Esparza, HB fucking O, Saturday. I need for you people to fucking join on Friday.
Yeah, man.
And then do what fucking black people do with a suit after a wedding. They bring it back on Monday and say it didn't fit. Say you don't like it. I don't know. No, be a decent American. Join HBO. Get some for the holidays. What do you got?
I got my dates for October. Can I mention them?
Absolutely,
bro. I'm going to be at Zany's in Nashville.
Oh, shit.
Next week. Club. They got weed over there?
Yeah, I got weed everywhere, bro.
All right. And then the following, the same week, I'm also doing Huntsville, Alabama.
That's a good one. So you're doing Zany's on Wednesday and Huntsville Thursday, Friday, yes. Saturday? Yeah, beautiful.
So if everything goes right, I'm going to be at the Edmonton, Alberta, Canada the following week at the, I think it's called the Punchline in Edmonton.
Beautiful.
In Canada.
Check me out, Canadian motherfuckers, go check
them out. Check it out. I'm bringing Rodrigo Torres, so watch out.
Oh, shit, Silent
Bob. We might do a Canadian podcast over there. And I'm doing the Humphreys by the Bay in San Diego, California. This is all in October. And the following day, I'm doing Reno, the Silver Legacy Casino. Get all the information on FelipeSworld.com. Also, I'd like to mention that I'm going to release my album, the comedy special, on a vinyl. You know, I think, you know, the fans is on vinyl. One? Yeah, it'll be on vinyl.
Beautiful.
Okay. It'll be released on November 30. It'll be a double album. Double record album, because it's under 1 hour, so we got to split it up in 15 minutes each side. So it's going to be a collector's item. You know, it also come with a little, one of the little things where you get the comedy out of it. What's it called? A little chip or whatever.
Oh, a USB?
A USB. Yeah, so it'll be a collector's item album, November 30. And then right after, the following day after the special airs, it'll be on everywhere. HBO, HBO Go, HBO Latino, and maybe you could order it on Amazon. I don't know.
There you go, cocksuckers. All in one fucking thing, all right? I'll see you motherfuckers in Pittsburgh next week.
Thank you very much for having a podcast. Always, thank you, Church of What's Happening listener, for supporting me even when I'm not on a podcast and asking me, when are you going to be on a podcast?
That's right.
So I'm always on. And also, anybody who's out there from the Church of the What's Happening family and the other one. You're the one that Red Band has, his people. They got my back too, man.
You got it, brother.
Yeah, man. Death Squad, Nashville. Death Squad, Montreal. You know what's up, my brother?
Stay black, cocksuckers. Yeah. Have a great weekend. Hit it, Lee.
Thank you very much.
A little Hector Lavoe off.
Where's the restroom, man?
Whatever the fuck it is. This is a tremendous song. Khalil, another fucking jam. I'm going to turn
you on. Hector Lavoe, let's take for that.